If we want justice, we should come with clean hands. If we want you to perform justice, I should also perform justice. If you want to deliver justice, I should also deliver justice. So Mahatma Gandhi said, those who seek justice must come with clean hands. India is still far away from a corruption-free nation. RTI is the right step in this direction. The government, public authorities, citizenry have to work in unison to achieve the objectives of RTI Act. Ladies and gentlemen, liberties and rights are earned. They are never granted. They are never granted. Similarly, good governance is established. It just does not come without efforts. Thank you very much for giving me a patient here.
Mr. S. Bhale Rao Sahab, to take the discussion further ahead and followed by question and answer session.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. It's a great pleasure to be here today to talk about good governance. You should pardon me for repeating some things which have already been mentioned earlier. I'm doing that just to set up the base for my views on the subject. As you know, governance is derived from the word govern. And what does the word govern mean? It means conducting the policy and affairs of an organization, of a state, of a society, or a people at large through certain mechanisms of control, influence, and direction. So therefore, governance does not apply only to government, but it applies to all kinds of organizations where a set of people work together, come together, live together. Now, when we talk of good governance, as has already been mentioned, what does it really mean? It means that having good policies and good conduct, which goes towards the betterment, happiness, and satisfaction of the people. And in the case of government, it means doing public good. Now, what would be public good? Very simplest definition, it would be the greatest satisfaction of the largest numbers. Now, there are certain basics which have already been already mentioned earlier. I just reiterate them. One is, of course, the principle of the rule of law. Nobody is above the law. All institutions, all individuals must be governed by the principle of the rule of law. And there should be good laws. Laws which are closest to public morality and ethics. If a law is not ethical, it's not a good law. But always, all moral and ethical issues may not be covered by law. So therefore, we must draw that distinction and try to bridge the gap between the two. We have talked about the right to equality. Now, right to equality means what? It means equal treatment under the law and equal access to remedies under the law. Now, equal treatment really means that if a people who are similarly placed need to be treated in the same manner, it's not that everybody should be treated in the same way. It's not possible. We are not equal in many respects. But if there is a classification or a distinction made between different class categories, then that classification should be reasonable, it should be logical, and it should be based upon fairness. To give a very simple example, Today, if somebody wants to join the army, there are certain physical standards that are prescribed. You must have such a height, your chest weight must be so much, your chest, this thing should be so much. That doesn't mean that person who doesn't have that can get into the army, because the requirements of army are what they are. So therefore, you can put reasonable classification and restrictions, provided they are fair and they are based on some rational criteria. We have talked about transparency. And what do we mean by transparency? And this is particularly so in the case of government. Decisions must be taken in an open manner, based on some sound reasoning and logic. There is no place for nepotism or corruption. Whatever decision is done, it should be done by a competent person. It should be efficient, and as I said, it should be well informed. And more importantly, it should be in a consultative process, that all sections of society, stakeholders are consulted, and due weight is given to any opinion which may be in the minority. Accountability, we have said, and we know that, what it really means is that whoever takes decisions must be identified, identifiable, he should be answerable, and if a good decision is taken, it should be acknowledged and awarded. Bad decisions must face action and be punished. Now, as far as our country is concerned, for good governance, the most important document is really the Constitution of India. And all responsibilities of governance are distributed and shared between the three most important organs of the state, namely the legislature, the judiciary, and the executive. Each has its own sphere of activity. Each has to work in coordination without any what they call as a conflict of interests between each of them. So therefore, legislature, as you know, makes laws, has to make good laws. The executive, namely the government, the political executive and the bureaucracy, implements these laws, and the judiciary checks whether the laws are being implemented and whether the laws are good or bad. Now, it has often been said that government is best which governs the least. And our Prime Minister Modi ji has said, we want less of government and more of governance. Now, what does he mean by that? He says that government shouldn't be doing everything. There is no need for government to start selling bananas or tea or coffee or whatever. The basic function of government or governance is really to set up systems and procedures wherein, as I said, decision making is done for the betterment of public, for public good, and that the most people are satisfied with the result of this governance. Now, what do we mean by ensuring better governance? As Dr. Shahid has already talked about the RTI Act. Now there is a movement to take the matter further. And that movement really is what is called as the right to service. There are some states and many organizations which are working towards ensuring a law which provides the right to service. For example, I want water connection in my house. It is the municipality's job to give me a water connection. That's a service that they have to provide. I pay the necessary fees for it. and then the responsibility of the municipality is to ensure that within a reasonable time that connection is given. Same thing in the case of electricity, same thing with many other kinds of services that. So therefore, the right to service is now a new area where a lot of work is being done, and I'm sure that we need to support such kind of movements. There are some departments and government agencies which have developed the citizens' charters, which again go towards ensuring and telling public that what services they will provide, and if that is not provided, what remedies do they have. Now, in our case and in country, there is, as Dr. Shahid had said, a lot of mistrust. We think that people are going to cheat the system, whereas actually those who cheat the system are only a small number. So therefore, our whole mindset needs to be changed. We need a set of reforms, reform the bureaucracy and others. On the Right to Information Act, I remember a person was asked to give information. He did give the complete information. So when he was pulled up, he says, "I am being economical with truth." So therefore, this kind of thing is also being done by some of us in the bureaucracy who are quite fluent with our language. Now, lastly, I think good governance comes only by electing good people, electing good political parties, not getting swayed by what they promise in their manifestos or during elections, but what solid work they do as far as governance is concerned. Well, I'll stop at this stage because I'm sure we would have lots of discussion on this. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Any questions, please? Godless mic.
Actually, it was very informative, and today I think I got the profound knowledge of RTI. My question is, RTI has been implemented from the year 2005, but even though RTI was implemented, the rate of corruption, scandals, scams all over the India has considerably increased in our country. So does RTI can inculcate honesty in public authorities?
Right to information, that's okay. But we also have seen, we have been observing, we're reading, that somehow the agencies, the institution take recourse under some or the other law to protect the information what is demanded from the public. What do you have to say? And about that, you know, moral and ethical fabric is getting spoiled when we see in the newspaper every day that it is my right to speak and right to express, and you are hurting the religious or other sentiments of the people. So how far RTI is really doing the service?
Dr. Yusuf, RTI aim to remove corruption. This is one of the objectives act, but it's not the only mechanism to remove the corruption. Corruption, as you said, despite RTI, there is a lot of scams, there is a lot more corruption still there. RTI is a regime to get the information, to bring the transparency, to bring the accountability. RTI is...
You're right, a lot more is required to be done, much more than RTI. As I said, good governance has to be established, and there's a lot more is required to be done. And one of the most important thing, and Mr. Bhadara has also mentioned, is the mindset of the bureaucracy, the mindset of those who govern us, which includes policy makers, parliamentarians, executive, and so on and so forth. Unless that mindset is not changed, RTI itself will not be sufficient and enough to remove the corruption. But it's one of the important tools in the hands of citizenry of this country to use it and to check on the governance of the country. I agree that a lot more is required to be done beyond rate of this RTI is one of them. Now, I must also add that RTI in itself is not a grievance redressal mechanism. It's not a grievance redressal mechanism. As Mr. Bhajirao says, now there are more things are coming into force, like citizen's charter, like right to service. You have to tell your citizen that if you apply, how many days reply will come and how many days work will be completed. So rights of a citizen to know about his whatever he wants to be done from the government is coming into force. All these laws, once they are in force and when this regime comes into existence, will definitely improve the accountability of the government or the executive, which hopefully will lead to a less of, I will not say corruption free, but less corruption in the governance. And Dr. Shahida, you had talked about ethics and morality. Will you please repeat your question? I missed it.
Yeah, I just said that RTI does give power in the hands of
justified. And any right, and particularly there's a saying, those who belong to law, that you have freedom to move your fist in any direction till somebody's nose starts. Exactly. So you're not going to blow somebody's nose because I have freedom to move it anywhere. So it is it's a well-established principle of jurisprudence that you have freedom to move your fist anywhere till somebody's nose starts. So you cannot hit somebody else. So whether it is freedom of expression or freedom of your religion or practicing any religion, it should not be used to cause whatever you're referring to hurt others, to hurt the sentiments, etc., etc. All rights, and those who are from legal background sitting in this hall otherwise, all rights are not without reasonable restrictions. This is a well-known principle. Whether it is freedom of expression, whether it is freedom of profession or religion or life or anything, is not without a reasonable restriction. This word is used by courts repeatedly. And what is a reasonable restriction? Is being interpreted time and again in different judgments and in different pronouncement by Supreme Court and High Court. Even right of information, which I talked about, has restrictions. We can deny information under Section 8, under various exceptions like the security of a state, like friendly relationship to neighboring countries, by the diplomatic relationship, so and so forth, even agreement with foreign countries, or things like that. There under Section 8, there are 9 or 10 clauses are given where this right of information can be denied. Simultaneously, there is a very strong presentation for right of secrecy also. And it's coming, and the Government of India has put on its website a white paper on the subject. And they are now talking about that along with the right to information, there should be right of secrecy also. Now, secrecy is a term which is very relative. For me, something maybe my private right or private secrecy, I want to maintain it. For example, as they say, in Western world, if you ask somebody's, caste, they don't have a caste system, they ask somebody it's a very insulting thing. In our country, telling a caste is something we feel proud of it. I'm Sharma, I'm Srivastava, I'm so and so forth. Now, this is a social background. So, secrecy or personal rights, or for example, somebody can ask, and the such questions keep coming to us about the medical reports of the government officers. RTI we receive that somebody has been selected as some officer or professor. What is the medical report? Now, should I tell him that his blood group is B plus, he's suffering from arthritis or things so forth? It's a personal information. So again, there are a lot of curtailment and things being talked about. So any right of information does not amount a license for any violation of such rights, which may lead to rights or whatever you may call it, which may lead to I'm not finding an appropriate word, which may lead to disharmony in the society. It may not lead to such thing. So if any right or any provision is misused, there will be definitely a curtailment on that. And there should be a curtailment on that. Thank you very much.
Professor Shahid has said, a lot of instances of even the misuse of the RTI Act have been coming up. To be a very close and recent example, we've got a letter written by somebody from Uttar Pradesh asking all the details about the residential coaching academies in all the five centers where it is being there. Now he has asked, questions like, give the name of each and every book that is there in your library. Who is the publisher? What is the cost? Did you negotiate and bring down the price? Then he said, in the hostel, what menu is given every day? What is the cost to each? Now, he has asked about 30 odd such questions. Now, surely he is somebody who is involved with the academies and therefore he has some axe to grind. And therefore he is asking all these questions. So such kind of misuses are also coming. And in fact, statistics have shown that almost 70% cases are those government officials themselves asking questions about their own cases. So that kind of misuse does occur. But nevertheless, just because some people are misusing it doesn't mean that the act is bad or it should be thrown out. And in fact, this act is another wonderful example. I keep telling everybody whenever I have such occasions to address gatherings that even it is good for the bureaucracy, because now people will know who has taken the decision. If a certain officer is transferred from X to Y place, he doesn't know who has passed that order, whether it is the secretary who has done it or whether it is the minister who has done it. So therefore, now in the file it will all be noted who has done that decision, why he has taken that decision, and therefore, people will get exposed. So this is a good way of where even corruption can be brought down. And accountability doesn't necessarily mean bad thing. It also means that there is a protection to people who are taking decisions, that if they are taking decisions,